This is a network cable connector that most of you have probably not seen before. It's mostly used in enterprise and business situations, particularly when you want to run longer distances like with fiber. But it doesn't have to just be used with fiber. It can also be used with copper connections and also can even be used with your standard RJ45 cables with an adapter or transceiver like this one I'm holding. And I've actually had to use these connectors for at least one of my devices, so I figured I'd make a video talking about them. Now, this is not going to be a video where I say you have to go out and buy one of these. Definitely not. This is totally overkill for a home use, but it's still good to know about, and some of you might come across a rare scenario where it does make sense to use. Now, I'm not going to be able to cover everything, so if you're an expert, don't expect to learn anything new, but if you're just a regular tech enthusiast, you should find this pretty interesting. Now, this type of connector is called SFP. It stands for Small Form Factor Pluggable. And it works much the same way that you're familiar with a regular Ethernet RJ45 connector. You'll have switches that may have both RJ45 and some of these SFP connectors, or it could be an enterprise switch that literally only has SFP connectors on it. And there's actually several different versions that have different speeds. So SFP is 1 gigabit per second, SFP plus is 10 gigabit, SFP 28 is 25 gigabit, QSFP 28 is 100, QSFP 56 is 200, and QSFP 56 DD is 400. Now, as for why you would use an SFP connector instead of an RJ45 connector, even if you're using copper for both of them, is SFP has way lower latency. For example, according to this latency chart, which is in microseconds, a copper SFP cable called DAC is about 1/9 the latency of RJ45, and a fiber SFP connector is about 1/26. Don't worry about the number of links. I think that's just if you're connecting multiple cables as one connection, but the ratio is the same for all of these. Now, for a home user, even though these differences are relatively large, you would never notice the difference. Remember, these are in microseconds, not even milliseconds. But for an enterprise situation where you have a data center where you're connecting hundreds or thousands of different switches and connections, then that latency can definitely matter. And I believe a lot of times these SFP connections might be used between switches. Even if the switches mostly are RJ45 Ethernet, they might have one or two SFP ports that are used specifically to connect to aggregation switches, I believe they're called, which are basically all SFP connections, and those are used to connect switches at low latency. But then each individual device would be RJ45. Now, another of the main advantages of SFP is you can use it with fiber optic cables. So basically, this would be in three parts. You'd have two connectors on each side, and then the cable is separate, and you plug that into each connector. And this will allow you to do much longer cable runs than you would with a copper cable, and also potentially much more bandwidth depending on the type of fiber and the protocol you're using. Now, as for advantages for having a switch that supports SFP is mostly that it's very adaptable. So you could have a switch that has both RJ45 and SFP on it, and obviously the RJ45 is for your typical connections, but then in that SFP port, you could use a copper SFP cable, you could use a fiber SFP cable, or you could even put in a SFP to Ethernet RJ45 transceiver and still use that port for RJ45. Now, this is still going to all depend on the speed and version of the SFP port. So it's going to be either SFP or SFP plus, typically on like entry-level enterprise switches, which is going to be either 1 or 10 gigabit per second. But if you're going higher end, you might see one that's SFP 28 or even higher. Though you do have to be aware that SFP and SFP plus are not necessarily backwards compatible. It's going to depend on the switch. So typically you can plug a SFP connector into an SFP plus connector, but you still might need to go into that switch and force it to use the lower speed. So it's not exactly as easy as plugging like a regular Ethernet cable into a 10 gig where it automatically does that. It might auto negotiate, but it might not. Another disadvantage, or at least something you need to be aware of, is that these transceivers that go from SFP to RJ45 are not necessarily universally compatible with all switches. So typically you're going to want to look on the product page and make sure that it is compatible with the switch brand that you're using and might have to have some special firmware. For example, I have this TP-Link transceiver that I bought, and it actually does not work in my UniFi switch as far as I can tell, but it does work in my Netgear switch. So that was just me assuming that it was compatible, but it didn't explicitly say it, and I now have to just use this with the other switch. Now, that being said, I believe if you're not using a transceiver and it's just a copper cable with SFP connectors on the end, I don't think that needs to be compatible. I think that's all standardized. It's just if you're using the transceiver that converts from RJ45 to SFP. And another obvious disadvantage is you need to buy these transceivers if you want to use it with RJ45, which they can definitely add up. For SFP, which is only 1 gigabit, then it's like maybe $20, not too bad. But if it's a 10 gigabit SFP plus, it's probably gonna run you about $50 plus. Also, another disadvantage is you can't do anything like power over Ethernet with an SFP connector. It's only data. Another thing I would say is a disadvantage is you sometimes need to use caution when using these type of connectors. For example, if it's a transceiver, those things can get pretty hot. Some of them up to 70 degrees Celsius, which can burn your skin, third degree burns, in under a second. So if you accidentally touch it, you better have good reflexes. Now, I doubt it'll run at that max temperature all the time, but still will be pretty hot. Also, if you're using fiber, you have to be careful not to look into the end of the fiber cable if it's active, because it's technically a class 1 laser from what I've read, and it is not visible light. So there was actually a guy on Reddit who looked into the end of a cable and didn't realize there was actually light coming out of it that he couldn't see, and his eye ended up hurting, and he had to go to a doctor who said there was some inflammation. I don't believe there was any permanent damage, but still, something to be aware of. Another interesting thing is the locking mechanism. So if it's cable like this, there might be a pull tab on it, and when you pull on it, it will release this little latch. You might see how it kind of tilts and unlocks. Whereas if it's a transceiver like this, you actually pull down on this little lever and that unlocks it, and then you pull out. Whereas if you put it up, it's in the lock position when you put it in. Now, as for why I had to initially deal with this connector is my NAS, it's a Synology. I wanted to use 10 gigabit with it. And several years ago when I was looking, I believe at the time they only had an expansion card for 10 gigabit that used SFP Plus. They do now sell 10 gigabit Ethernet, but I'm pretty sure that wasn't at the time. So I got that. And one thing I found out is 10 gigabit switches are expensive on their own, but if you even add a single SFP port, it's just gonna make the cost way higher. Now, as a side tangent story, I would not actually recommend this particular Netgear router because it seems to have some issues when you're going from a 10 gig to 1 gig connection. And I found this out because I was having major issues with dropped frame rates while trying to stream a game from my computer to my TV. Basically, the setup was the switch has a 10 gigabit connection coming in from my computer and then a 1 gigabit connection going out to the Apple TV. And when I have it set up like that, the connection is crap. It is literally unplayable. It's laggy. I couldn't figure it out. But if I hook up another 10 gigabit switch that I have in between the Apple TV and this Netgear, so it has a 10 gigabit connection going in and out. It's just that there's an extra switch in between that is now doing the 10 to 1 gigabit conversion. That is a perfect connection. There's no issues. And I also tried this with it going directly to the Apple TV and another switch, still the same issue. So it's not like you can say it's a cable because I literally added an extra step and that fixed the connection. So something's going weird. That being said, I have this other Netgear switch, which only has 2 10 gig ports. That one works fine. So I think it's just this one. So anyway, side tangent over, this switch has issues, wouldn't recommend it. So anyway, I think that's a pretty good basic level intro to these connectors. You don't have to be an expert, but if you ever do come across it, now you'll know what it is. Let me know what you think down in the comments and if you use these connectors yourself and why you have to use them. If you enjoyed this video, definitely give it a big giant thumbs up for the YouTube algorithm. And if you want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is where I was talking about a industrial looking Ethernet cable that I bought. So I'll put that link right there. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.